Yeah, I think we'll have to all stay behind here and try to track them. Information together. So what I asked him to do in addition to make the painting was
I am not in the C-Spring as well. So this Patrick O'Brien, as most of you here probably know, is the writer of a lot of really terrific books about the sea. I get this all the time. I'm over at the 60 Corps for the last couple of weeks, and I've heard it 10 times already. They're like, oh, you mean you picked it too? You know, I got that once at an opening at a gallery in Annapolis. Some guy comes up and he's like, I'm a big fan of your work, but, you know, I've only read your novels. I didn't know you painted. So, and I was like, should I tell him? So, for those of you not familiar with my work, I'll show you some examples of my paintings, and then I'll get into how I put my paintings together, and then we'll talk about Stonington in particular. So these are some of my paintings. Of course, you can see some right here, but I like to paint old boats. Ever since I was a little kid, I like old ships, and so these are some examples of some of the kind of things I do. Because I'm an American, and most people want to see American scenes, I cover the War of 1812 and the Barbary Wars and the Mediterranean. Up into the Civil War, when sail began turning into steam. So I've done a lot of battle scenes. And ships at sea, that's similar to this painting. But it's not all wars. Every once in a while, I like to paint some peaceful scenes. Sometimes I go a little bit into modern times. The thing about New York, I like New York in the 1930s, 40s, is always interesting. Sometimes I go into more modern times. This is I'm doing a series of commissions for Lockheed Martin, with these new Japanese destroyers that are being built in Japan. Lockheed is providing just the missiles, not the missiles, but the missile launcher. And what they do is they, apparently it's common in Japan to give a corporate gift. And so Lockheed commissioned me to do these paintings, and then as a corporate gift, they give it to the ship itself. And then the ship built a niche. When they built the ship, they built a little niche in the wardrobe just for the painting. So it had to be exactly the right size. So these paintings are sailing around the world. And then, strangely, it was really actually by coincidence, I did almost the same thing for ExxonMobil. They were building these things in Japan, and they were giving a corporate gift to the shipyard that did the paintings. So sometimes I'll do a lot of paintings. So that's a bit about the kind of artwork I do. Now this is where I do it. I live in Baltimore, and there's these old restored mills. This is, in fact, it's called the Clipper Mill, because they used to make cotton duck there that was used to make clipper ship sails that were then built down at the harbor in Baltimore, a big shipbuilding town. And so it's been recently restored, and it looks a lot like this building here, I suppose. There's a lot of artists in there, various arts and things like that. So you can see I've got those big warehouse down in those. But then when my son was young, we decided it would be a good idea just to move back home to see if he's here. I didn't mean to show all these pictures, but that was my house before, and then we started building something on the back that's getting out of the basement, building this. So that's the studio that I work in now. That's where I spend almost all my time. I wish I had a little pointer. It's not always the corner. That's the studio. And then this is sort of a side gig. I teach painting at the Maryland Institute of College of Art in Baltimore and like that. So, really quickly, a couple of highlights of my career. career that Russ already mentioned. I had the show at the Naval Academy Museum. They borrowed some of the paintings back from various people that bought them over the years. That's the curator there. He's not touching the paintings. Not quite, though. This was a real highlight of my career, I thought. They gave me this award at this big gala event at the National Press Club in Washington, D.C. So I got to stand up there and pontificate a little bit, so that was kind of, that's always fun. And then...
You're a young man.
I know. So that was the, what was that, the Distinguished Service Award, but that as that merits had a reason, that's the Outstanding Service Award. So that's different. And then I got to pontificate a little bit more again. Yeah, I was down in Jamestown, Virginia. So, before I move on, I'll tell you just a little story about an interesting thing that happened. I had an exhibition of paintings in Portsmouth, Virginia, 2007. It's a big Civil War town, so it was this nice gallery right on the main street in Portsmouth. And they had all my paintings there of Civil War subjects. And the National Maritime Historical Society put it on their magazine and did a thing on the inside. You know, the gallery put together this nice opening. They even had, up here you can see these guys up there singing sea shanties at the opening. That was really nice. About a week after the show closed, this happened. So what happened was the church next door to the building burned down. So the church was on the right there. This is the building here. But the building was heavily damaged, very heavily damaged. And so what happened was the city came along and knocked down the building. So they didn't, and the firefighters didn't allow the owners to go in and get anything. Not even, the windows were all blown out, so they were like, yeah, but we can just stand on the sidewalk and reach in and grab at least something. They said, no, we can't even do that. So they knocked the whole building down with all the antiques and all the paintings on the sidewalk. So I lost three paintings that still belong to me, but the thing is, most of the paintings had already been sold, but a lot of them hadn't been delivered because they were bought online. So a lot of the people who had bought the paintings, they were the ones that were out. But the main thing was the owners of this gallery, they lived upstairs. So in one day they lost their house and their business and all their inventory all at once. And it wasn't even their fires, you know, it was the church next door. So luckily my favorite painting was So this was the one painting that was on the cover of the magazine. That one they pulled out of the road. And they said, you know, they called me on the phone, you know, it's not that bad of a shape, you know, you can probably just, we'll send it back to you, you can probably just get it restored. So this is what it looked like. To me, that's not restorable. So that was a total loss. So, that's enough about me. So let's talk about making the paintings, how I make these paintings. So I'll talk about making historical paintings in general and then get more specific about Stonington. So it all begins with research, a lot and a lot of research. Most people don't realize that there's time to do all the research and more than the painting itself. I like to read first person accounts, old letters, journals written by the people who are actually there. Journal letters, memoirs. I look at a lot of old maps, like that's the Chesapeake Bay there. And that's the map of Battle of Chesapeake drawn by the French, it looks like. And then I got to be friends with the curator at the Naval Academy Museum. He let me go through all these old books that he's got back in his office. Mm-hmm. The coolest one was this one here, especially impressed me. This is a British signal book from 1795. So in those days, in order for ships to talk to each other, they flew signal flags that had code. Code wasn't standardized yet like it is now. So but what they needed to do was change the code every once in a while, because once the enemy learns your code, it's not good anymore, so you got to change it every once in a while. And everybody on every ship has to have one of these code books. So this book is, it was totally hand-painted. All those little flags are all hand-painted. All the writing was all hand-painted. So you can see, like, for instance, if you fly that flag, the red and white flag with the blue and white under it, that means to engage the enemy, in other words, to attack the enemy. If closer, in other words, if I want you to attack them closer, your red pendant will be shown over the flag. That kind of thing. Oh. So, you know, by using something like this, I can get the flags right on my ships. Well, nobody can tell me that I got it wrong. Because it seems like there's always people out there who know more than you do about flags. And there's somebody else who knows more than you do about sails, and somebody else knows about wave and wave patterns than you do. You know, and then these people can't wait to point out the problems. We call them rivet counters, people who they look at a painting and they'll count the rivets and make sure you got the right amount of patterns. There's probably some rivet counters in this room. Me personally, I don't mind that. I mean, as long as they tell me before the painting's done, then that's the whole point. We got a rivet counter right over here. Chief rivet counter. But luckily I talked to him before he did the painting. So this is a really good book. This book is very comprehensive about how they sailed these ships in the old days, and you can learn all the various specific things about the rigging. You know, to the untrained eye, the rigging looks like this confusing spider web, but it all makes sense when you know the system. It all makes perfect sense. I did a painting of the, interesting aside, I did a painting of the Kalmar Naval, which is a ship from the 16th, a reproduction of a ship from the 1500s, Swedish ship. And they have an unusual old-fashioned bowsprit where they have a mast on top of the bowsprit, and the sails are unusual, not the same kind of sails in these more recent ships. And in this book, I was doing the painting, so I was using this book, and in this book, she talked about how the sails on that bowsprit mast couldn't be set properly. When you use both sails, they wouldn't work properly, and they had to sort of jury rig it, and it didn't really work. And then I talked to the captain of the Kalmar Nickel, who actually used those sails. And she goes, "You can use them, I do it every day." So this is like sort of in theory, but she was sort of doing it in practice. And so they actually contacted the writer and told him, "Look, it does work. Actually do it." So if they print a new edition, they'll change that bit. I sometimes use this as a good example of how they furl sails. Talk to the experts in the field wherever I can. See, I've been doing this a lot there. It's pretty good. So that's the USS Constitution in Boston. I was lucky enough to go on the turnaround cruise a couple. So what they do, once a year, they'll take the Constitution as a U.S. Navy ship. It's a museum ship, but it's also a U.S. Navy commissioned ship. The people on board are U.S. Navy sailors and officers. And but what they do is they take it out into Boston Harbor once a year. They make a bit of a celebration out of it, turn it around, and bring it back to the pier on the other side. Because apparently, the rain and the wind generally come from one direction in the snow. And so if you want to turn the vessel around periodically so it doesn't weather all on one side. And so since they have to do that, they kind of make a party out of it. And luckily I got invited to go do that. So I got to really, crawl around on this ship, everywhere on this ship. This is in the captain's quarter gallery. Some of you may know that's where the captain had his seat of ease. In other words, where he could go to the bathroom there. Nobody else. That was his personal bathroom. Mm-hmm. Everybody else had to use a couple of holes carved in the wood up on the head up front, but he had his own little bathroom. But I thought it was the best seat in the house. Nobody else was down there for some reason. I love those curved windows. So it was right there. You see those white curved windows up near the stern? It's right there is those windows that I'm seeing. And we fired cannon at the entrance. There's a fort at the entrance of the harbor. fire cans at them, and they fired some cans back. Incredibly loud, and you're under there, you know, in an unclosed space, and one of those cannons goes off, but you can imagine 22 of them going off continuously during a battle. Carronades up on the weather pit, they have carronades. Always accompanied by a large flotilla of various boats, fire boats, fore and aft. This is the captain. He really got into his role. The captain currently, that was the captain a couple of years ago, the captain is currently a woman, and she wears it too. I was at an event down in D.C., a different event, and she was there walking around in her 1812 car. That's the younger generation just couldn't hack it, you know. It's like 4 full hours with no USB ports, no phone chargers. Oh, okay, so now I want to show you a little bit about doing some research, and then I'm going to talk about Stonington. So I have to get out of this. So this is just a 3-minute video that I made. Oh, it's about the ship I just talked about, the Calmar Nicol, the one from the 1500s. It's a video I made about making that video. Basically the same process that we use for that's why I'm including this most recent one. So get out of this. So we could do some questions now if you want to do before I start about this comment.
Yeah, with you.
All right, we'll get into this. All right. a lot of you probably know a lot about this battle, some of you probably know more. But basically, it took place during the War of 1812. The British came up along Long Island Sound and then up Fisher Sound to attack Stonington this way. It's the long and short of it. Sort of, there's nobody. The military reason for attacking Stonington is a little unclear. Nobody's really exactly sure why they bothered with this little village of Stonington. There's talk about that the villagers were harboring torpedoes in those days. Apparently, torpedoes in those days, a torpedo was what we would call a mine today. It was basically a keg filled with gunpowder and whatever else. And you could row out to a ship and attach it to the hull of the ship and then row away and then it would explode. So the British considered that very unhonorable. You know, in those days, they liked to fight wars with honor, you know, and that was considered more or less just terrorism. A ship up that way. So the captain of this British fleet, Captain Hardy, was by all accounts a real gentleman, a decent fellow, and had no interest in killing innocent civilians, but he was got instructions from on high that these darn American terrorists were, you gotta go get those torpedoes. And then they're because I'm going to be showing a lot more pictures. There was the other excuse was that there was the wife of the British Vice Consul was being held in somewhere down in Fairfield or not Fairfield.
New London.
Hmm? New London. And so Hardy came along, and that was sort of the pretense for attacking Stonington. So, but the thing is, the British had quite a strong force with them. They had 5 ships, 160 cannon, Congreve rockets, 2 mortars. I'll explain Congreve rockets. This is what Stonington, this is what you guys know. You guys, that's how we all watch it. This is what a Congreve rocket was. So a Congreve rocket looked more or less like, you know, bottle rockets that we have nowadays, basically like a giant bottle rocket. And they were invented by a guy named Congreve, and they had these special launchers on the ships. That's what is referred to in the Star Spangled Banner, and they say the rockets red glare. They're referring to Congreve rockets. Turns out they weren't all that effective there. You can't really aim them, and apparently when they hit, they don't really do a whole lot of damage. But they were probably pretty scary to look at when they're coming your way.
Yeah.
So Captain Hardy approaches the town, and he decides to send a note in by at least sends a boat into town with a note saying, essentially, I don't really want to kill you guys, but I have to destroy your town, so you've got an hour to get out of town, and I'm going to bomb you into oblivion. And that's essentially what he said. And they were like, what? Who, us? What do we do? So they sent a note back, sort of pleading their case, and there was some notes going back and forth, but anyway, he decided in the end to start bombarding. And the people had mostly left and gone back and into the distance, and so the bombardment started, and I'm told, I read in one place that the British were mistaken and they felt that the town was further back than it was. And so a lot of their shots went over the town. Some of them fell short and some of them went over, but a lot of them hit. And but apparently, because the houses were wood and relatively modest, surprisingly they did less damage than they would have otherwise. They had more substantial brick buildings, stone buildings. Might be more heavily damaged and knocked down by all the mortars and the cannonballs. But the wood building, the cannonballs go right through there. Because these things, most of them were not, cannonballs were just heavy metal balls. They didn't, every time you see a movie, a cannonball goes off and hits somewhere and explodes. But they were just heavy metal balls. They just throw metal in the end, mostly. The mortars were firing these things that they called stink pots, which So then the you guys, villagers, got together, and some of the young men decided that they would fight back, and sort of foolishly, and they got their, they had two cannons, and they initially put one of their cannons down here at the point where the flag is now, and started firing, but that was sort of too exposed, so they realized they had to give up that cannon. So what they did was they spiked it, which means you hammer some metal into the touch hole of the cannon so that you can't light it anymore. Because once they abandoned it, they figured the British would get it. They don't want the British to have it, so they spiked it. And then they brought it up to the fort, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. And then when they ran out of power, they spiked that gun as well. So then they didn't have any guns. But then when they were able to find some power, they unspiked that gun. So I guess the spiking wasn't all that effective because they brought it up to the blacksmith and unspiked it. So I guess the enemy could have done that too. But and then they were able to fire at the British with their one gun, and they were really quite effective. They really did a really good job, which we'll talk about a little bit later. So when I was researching the battle that happened over the course of 3-4 days, I thought that the most interesting part of the battle was that point where the villagers were fighting back, were firing back. Because after a while, after they fired back for a little bit and chased off one of the British boats, damaged it quite a lot and chased it off, then the British just sailed further out into the sound and just anchored off there far enough away that we couldn't hit them. And then they bombarded the town from there. There's nothing we could do about it because they're too far away. And so at that point, that part of the battle was over. At that point, the British continued to bombard for a little while, and then unclear why precisely, but they decided they'd have enough. Hardy sort of, I think he sent a note in saying, you know, you convinced us you don't have any torpedoes, and you convinced us that you don't have any control over the wife of the Vice Council. You know what? And we'll just take off. So they kind of just left. You know, I mean, Jim can tell the story in exact detail, but that's the gist of it. But I'm going to get into it a little bit more later. So Jeremiah Holmes was sort of the hero on the American side. He was a guy, I think he's from Mystic, and but earlier in his life he had been captured by the British. What the British used to do was impress sailors, in other words, basically kidnap them. Literally, they would go into pubs in seacoast towns in England, and the young man of military age, they would literally kidnap them and bring them on the ship, and their family would never see them again, probably. And that's why the ships never really came into port, because everybody, but most people would desert. So anyway, one reason for the war in 1812 is that they were impressing sailors on American ships. A British ship sailing out in the Atlantic would come across an American ship, come aboard and say, hey, we think that guy's British, that guy's British, that guy's British, we're taking them. And they took these sailors, and sometimes they were British, sometimes they weren't. But that was one reason that really made the American government mad and decided to put it with support. That and some trade policies, and so that's why the War of 1812 started. But he was one of the guys that was impressed. He was an American, but the British pressed him. And while he was on board the British ship, he learned gunnery. He was a gunner, and he learned how to fire a cannon very well. He was there for 3 years, I think. And then until he finally convinced them that he was an American. He somehow managed to get out of his service. But what he learned while he was with the British came in pretty handy at this battle, because he was the one who was in charge of the gun. Same gun that's right up there in Cannon Square, that same gun, he was in charge of that. Firing and destroying this British ship, trying to destroy it. So I like this quote from Jerzy's Decay's book. It is tempting to shrug off the battle, just a case of King George's men bumping into furniture. I like that line. But questions remain. What prompted the attack? It was unexpected and unprovoked. There seemed to be no military reason for it. What made the Yankees so preposterous to break? Uh-oh. Come on. That's unfortunate.
Tell me a little bit about it.
Yeah. so.
Gotta speak up about the mic.
Okay, I need a mic. So the point that I'm depicting is the fort, the Grasshopper Fort, which was right out here. There's a plaque over here, and I did some digging with a map, superimposing an old map on top of the modern Google Maps to see exactly where that fort was. And it turns out that plaque said near here was the fort, but actually, from what I can tell, it was there. Not there near, but it actually partially covered it. And then right out in the water was, the one British ship that really approached really close was really quite close by. It was they called Shouting Distance. I guess we don't see right up there where it was. Because the British ship, this British ship, they were trading insults with the guys. For instance, when the Americans ran out of powder, one of the British yelled out, "Hey, send us some more cannonballs, we're running low." And one of the Americans said, "As soon as we get some powder, we'll send you plenty more." So in the writing by the people who were there about the battle, they say that this exchange took place. So from that we know that they might have been busted across the channel. And to describe it as the distances in those days were in the naval accounts were usually described as pistol shot, muscle shot, cannon shot, I guess. But they were described as pistol shot bullets. And as a pistol fire, thus far, muscle shot. But it's not an exact, I don't think it's an exact measurement, but pistol shot is X number of feet. But generally, they were described as pistol shot away, close enough to the other two. That's pretty darn close, lasting to the cannon. So I'm showing two balls there. I'm showing two balls coming out of the cannon. And then there was also guys firing their muskets at the British as well. So this is the one cannon that was spiked and then unspiked and brought back and fired. Jeremiah Holmes at one point, strangely enough, maybe because the cannon had been spiked and then unspiked, he couldn't get the touch hole of the cannon to light the hole in the back of it. What you do is you pour some gunpowder into this little hole in the back, and the hole goes down into the barrel where the gunpowder is in there. You light that little bit of gunpowder at the top of it, and then he couldn't get that lit from underneath the hole. So what he would do, I think maybe he couldn't make the flame, couldn't make the flame. So what he did was he used his musket, his little one. He just held it up to the touch hole, just was able to play it off. And supposedly, some of those times when he was doing that, they decided to hear him whistle and hold his musket parallel to the barrels and just look at the musket. I think that was a bit of a problem because the one young man who was burned, from what I read, was burned by that musket. Burned in his, one of the only casualty. Nobody would know Americans were killed in the battle. Two people were injured. Mm-hmm. One guy who was injured is later. One guy was semi-blind and burned. I think by his musket shot.
That could be a short charge or not. Somebody that didn't work on the sponge on the battle. Right, what I'll say.
Yeah, so what you have to do between shots. And it gets really hot, and sometimes I can put the gunpowder and the ball down there. The gun itself is so hot, it explodes. You're supposed to worm out the gun. Some of these questions perhaps have been answered a little bit more fully a little bit later, as I'll talk about. So, research. That's the book that changed churches. That's how I started, with this book. But it was written a few decades ago, I think, and some new information has come to light. So then, after this book and some internet sleuthing,
Jimmy boy.
We went out. Jim has done a lot of research on the Nile, every, like Russell said, every 15 minutes, what everybody's doing, where the British are. They were able to go out and find some of the cannonballs and such underwater. They did a lot of underwater investigation to try to pinpoint the exact location of the ships. And Jim has been able to pinpoint the exact location of each ship every 15 minutes, which I use to place those ships exactly where they are. So none of that picture there is made up. It's all, everything about it is very carefully planned, as I'll show you. So I found a lot of old maps. Interestingly, those ones on the other side here, you can see they both show a windmill on a point. In fact, on the top map, it's called a windmill point. The Stonington is up there, and the point is called Windmill Point. So there was clearly a windmill there. We think that it was probably knocked down. There was a hurricane a couple years after the war of 1812. A couple years after this battle, it was probably knocked down. They replaced it with a light. And then later, they replaced it with a more permanent light.
These days, they call it a turbine, right?
Yeah. Turbine. It was a wind turbine. Yeah. So now, but this map here from 1827, very, very detailed. Here's a close-up of that. You can see in 1827, they've drawn every structure and stone walls and hedges and everything. This was actually a map, a side point. This map was drawn in order to decide whether they and where to make that breakwater right there. That breakwater that they're showing was in this scene speculative. But there's a breakwater there now, so I guess they did build it. So, getting closer, that's the really close to the point. Now at this point, in 1827, the lighthouse was no longer there. Somebody has handwritten the word light next to that round structure there at the point. Now I guess it's a flagpole. So now up there at the end of the breakwater, near that too, that's the fort, that curve there. That's the little fort that was called Grasshopper Fort. Turns out it was made out of turf. It was made out of earth, piled up about 4 or 5 feet high, about 60 feet long. So what I did is I took modern day view, right, and superimposed that old map on top of the modern day view. I lined up the streets. They got it pretty darn close in those days. Lined up the streets in Cannon Square there. That way I could figure out exactly where that fort was, right there. Hmm. Now, it's a little more instructive, though, to see this Google view. And if you superimpose the map on this, the old map on this view, you get that. Hmm. And then let's make that a little easier to see. You get that. So that's where the fort was.
If I'm correct,
so this is a picture I made of the viewpoint that I'm depicting. right? So we are, in my painting, we are at the point of that green triangle looking out this way. And that's the main ship that was there in the harbor that Jim Geary figured out where it was. Those lines there are the depth. And we figured that, the ship couldn't cross that line because of the depth. So that's as close as it could have been. It might have gone all the way up a little bit further, but in my picture, that's where I'm depicting it. Although, when I drew this, I had the ship the other way. Turned the ship the other way. I, in my painting, the ship is pointing north. Here, I've got a painting south. So that's the view. This is the view from approximately where the fort was. As you all are very familiar with, I'm sure, that's Fisher's Island out there. And then, I thought I had a view from the other side, but because I went out a couple of times and looked at the view, sort of tried to find exactly where those British ships were and got really interesting views of the town from there. This is a picture of the battle that was on a jug, like a water jug or something, that was made in Liverpool that the artist, I think, heard a description of the battle from a person who lived here. And it's a really kind of a pretty accurate view, considering the artist hadn't been here, and, you know, it's a pretty accurate view of Stonington and the point. And I think, what do you think of that corner? See up at the top little triangle with the church on it? I think that's right. So some other old pictures, but you know, in the old days, I use a lot of old illustrations, but you got to remember that, for one thing, those people were closer to the events, so you might think it's more accurate, but on the other hand, they didn't do the kind of research that's available now. They certainly didn't have the internet, but they didn't even have like historical societies and all that, and they could only draw kind of much more from their own imagination. They probably didn't make the long journey to Stonington in order to do the picture, you know. So you can get some information from old subjects like this, but not necessarily. You just have to be careful about what you get from them. So then I started having to do a lot of research on all the different aspects of the painting. Okay, like what were they going to wear? There were some militiamen there at the event, and so those guys at the top are some reenactors, but various clothing I could find from reenactors, and even on Google you can find some of these clothing that they're selling on this website I found that sells that type of clothing. The cannon that they had most likely had a what they sometimes call a caisson, which is the wagon that goes behind the cannon itself that holds the gunpowder and balls and ramrods and such. Call it a caisson or ammunition wagon. Huh. And we figured that there was probably one there. If they had a gun structure that's holding just the wagon, just the carriage, the gun carriage. And I had to research the flag a little bit. There's the reproduction there. It's, six, as you probably know, 16 stars and 16 stripes, which is very unusual, because apparently Tennessee came into the Union and they added a star and a stripe. I think in those days it was particularly standardized. You know, people were sort of on their own, I think, to do it. There wasn't a lot of communication with Washington. You must do this with your flag. So they made it 16 stars and 16 stripes, and then later, like the stars, it's very similar to the Star Spangled Banner down in Baltimore, but the Star Spangled Banner is 15 stars, 15 stripes. And then I think they decided, look, we can't keep adding stripes for every state. It's gonna be too many stripes, it's gonna be really good. So let's just stick with 13 stripes for the colonies, and we'll add a star for every state. So you guys have this strange 16 stripe flag. Research what all these little farm implements would have been, what kind of stuff would have been around, just the detritus, you know. They call that likely, or you ever heard that term? Like in movies, when you are decorating a set for a movie, you know, you build somebody's kitchen or whatever it might be, and then you add the life layer, and that is the children's stuff magneted onto the refrigerator, and the sugar's out, and the, you know, newspapers thrown around. That's the life layer, to make it seem realistic. So I wanted to add sort of that kind of thing to this, so just put some arrows and some shovels and buckets and things like that. You know, otherwise it looks too sterile. Like when they fire off these guns, you know, it's really surprising how much smoke comes out of the touch hole there, like especially those riflemen there, how much smoke is coming up next to their heads for that tiny little explosion happens there. And here you can see it over here, the little explosion happens back at the touch hole when the big one's going up there. So I had to look, that's the beauty of the end, right? Some of the, I also live near Fort McHenry in Baltimore, and I got to see really careful, you can take a slow-mo video of the, if you take a still photo of a cannon going off, you never get it. But if you take a slow motion video, go frame by frame, then you can get that yellow flash there. It's so fast that you can't photograph it. Yeah. So this must be a still from a slow motion video, I think. Yeah. What the heck did a window look like back to that? So that's what that is. Of course, those, they don't have any cloth on them there. That's the cannon, as you probably all know, that's the cannon, the dairy cannon that Jeremiah Holmes was fired in on that day. And then there, and that's the view. That's the exact view that I have. You can see Fisher's Island out there with that exact view of Fisher's Island. So I went out in my backyard and filmed myself doing all those poses. You can see I didn't have the costume, but it's good enough that I can then make the costume from there. But I did. Every one of those people are, in a sense, are me. So that's how I won the battles coming in all on this. But except for the little kid, apparently there were a few youths there. One I think is young as 11, a different person, different ages up, so I felt justified to putting the youth in there. But apparently they were all pretty young. A lot of these people who were at the fort were like 19, 20, 21. These were young. It's the young people that are reckless like that, right? Us old guys, we wouldn't go out there. You gotta be a young man. Got a flag and try various draperies because it's hard. I paint a lot of flags because I do a lot of American ships, and it's hard to just make that up to get the stripes right, to get the folds right. But I didn't actually have an American flag for sorority line, so I came the next day, and then I photographed it, trying to get it to the right, to interesting folds. I took probably 100 pictures of it in various different positions, trying to find a pleasing shape that I liked for the folds. What happened during the battle was the British ship that you see there, the big one, was really cut up by our fire quite a lot, and a lot of holes in the hull. And a few holes below the waterline, or just at the waterline, which is where the no problem, but the rigging was all cut up too, so finally it was a very, one thing about the flight, it was a very still day that day, almost no wind. And so at one point the flagpole got shot away, and Jeremiah Hall was ordered the flagpole to be put back up, and they nailed the flag to the mast. In other words, that means that the flag can't come down. In those days, that's how you surrender, was lower the flag. So if you nail your flag to the pole, that means we're not surrendering unless we're dead. And so they nailed the flag to the pole, and then apparently there was so little wind that they were afraid the British couldn't really see it because it was hanging slack. And so he took out his gun, his musket with a bayonet, used it to sort of hold down the flag to make sure they could see it. But then a little bit later, the wind came up a little bit from the north, and the British ship was able to cut its anchor cable and slip down and turn around and go and sort of drift with the wind back down out of cannon shot. And that's essentially the end of the Americans' part of the battle. So they, you can see, I put a little anchor buoy there. What they would do is they would anchor and put a little buoy there and mark the spot of the anchor. They were in such a rush to leave that they just cut their cable and then the anchor and the buoy. So I put the little anchor buoy there, and apparently the Americans promptly went out and got the anchor, brought the anchor up, and sold it to the American Navy, I think. So now it's time to start painting. So starts like that. That's my studio, Lone Woman. I always start by painting. I try to paint the whole painting at once. A lot of people think that maybe I'll paint a story on one side and just move down. But I always tell my students is you don't paint one part, then another. Like, don't paint the person, and then the can, and then this. You gotta paint the whole, bring the whole painting up all at once, because otherwise they won't feel like they belong to each other. The lighting will be a little bit different on each item if you paint them all separately. You paint the whole painting all at once. So that's just blocking. I just blocked in the general color of the sky, blocked in the water there, blocked in the general brownness down below. You can see I had the ship later. I realized I should have put the ship facing north instead of south. You can see in this picture, the ship's turning the other way around. Detailing up, filling in the different parts. So, like in, for instance, in this case, I'm just kind of blocking in the flag just to get the approximate colors. And then later, I would go back and detail it out. I was trying to, when I had cannon fire in the picture, what you have to make sure is the flash is the brightest thing in the whole picture, else it won't look bright. Mm-hmm. You want it to look super bright, so you have to make sure you don't have anything super bright else in the picture. Wow. Like the men's shirts or anything like that. The men are all wearing white shirts, but it's not really white. The paint that I use is not really white. It's a light gray. But in order to allow the cannon fire to be the brightest thing in the picture. Hmm. See, the white stripes and the white shirts, you might not be able to necessarily tell in a picture like this, but you can see when you look at that, there's nothing brighter than the cannon fire. Or like here. That sun and that reflection down there has to be lighter than anything else in the picture, or it won't look super bright. A little further on. I painted out the ship. I turned it around. Right. Yes. I originally had a dog running away, because I have dogs and my dogs hate fireworks. And I just thought it would be fun if I'm adding buckets and shovels and bric-a-brac and knickknacks and put a dog in there running away. But then I had it in there. I just decided it was too corny. It was too distracting. If I had more junk going on and he was just one of the many junks down there, then it would have been fine. But just to have the dog that prominent was, I thought, too distracting and too hard. Yeah. So I painted them out, sorry. And there's the final, that's the final painting. thing, but you're looking at a better version of it right there. Some close-ups. You can see the guy with the bayonet there, this guy. This guy's firing cannons. Caisson over there. The flag, we determined that the flag was so large that I think Jim Geary was making the point that the guy was standing on the fence. In the accounts of nailing the flag to the pole, the guy was standing on the fence and he boosted the youth onto his shoulders and he nailed it up. So that's 6 feet, 10 feet, maybe 12 feet up or something. But the flag is what, 18 feet, 20 feet long, something like that.
Yeah, so 12.
Yeah, so in that situation, in light winds, it would be hanging down and he would be fetching all the stuff. That's why I wanted to get that draper here, because I knew that the flag was going to be hanging on the ground or something. So I put some barrels there to hold up the flag to make it do it. That's what the flag is doing there. And it's also said that some of the people were, some of the Americans were sort of recklessly standing on top of the walls sometimes, just kind of taunting the British, you know, being foolhardy and brave. So I put that guy up at the top there to be sort of the focal point of the painting, just for the composition. And I wanted to have the whole composition sort of leading up to that cannon and that group of people there. You can see a guy back in the smoke there holding his ears. Whenever I see recreations of people firing off cannons, there's always some people doing that.
Yeah.
So I figured we probably were doing that in those days too. And some of the implements they have, one of them's got the tampon, like what you call a ramrod, and that screw type thing is called the wormer, I think, where after you fire a shot, you shove it in there and get all the debris out of the cannon before you load it again. You know, and I got my windmill up. Make sure I got that right. So there it is. Okay, so we're a little over time, but I want to leave you with this with this one little story about myself.
You have the annotated.
We have
on your slide.
No, okay. Over here we have. I have written down a lot of the different points of that battle of the painting that are shown on there. Explained on that board there. So, but I wanted to close with this. So, several years ago, my mother came over and she, you know, like probably a lot of people that have been clearing out their attic finally, and she has this box of stuff that she had saved from all her kids, and this was the box of the stuff that she had saved of mine. You know, like old report cards and old letters and some old artwork I had done. And, one of those things was this old watercolor. Apparently it was dated 1973, that makes me 13. So back then I used to spend a lot of time at the kitchen table and I would like do these elaborate scenes of knights jousting and Indians in teepees and Civil War scenes and ancient Rome. It's just kind of always what I like to do and I would create these little scenes. I can actually still remember doing that painting. And I was thinking, this is the best painting I've ever done. I mean, it's not a great painting, but what really struck me was when she brought it over, I was working on this painting at the time. I was literally working on this painting. It was for a children's book I did about the great ships. I was like, wow, what? And then for an earlier book, I did this painting. Apparently, I think Viking ships had red striped sails. It's probably something I saw as a kid, and ever after, that's my view of Viking ships, red striped sails. So that's when it sort of really struck me, seeing that really not much has changed. You know, just like when I was 13 years old, I sit in my studio by myself all day and create these elaborate historical scenes. You know, I've always known that I love my work, but it hadn't really struck me, you know, until then. Managed to build out a career out of what really comes naturally to me, what happens, what comes out of me anyway. It's what I would do even if I didn't need to work. And I plan to keep doing it for just as long as I can go with it. So one more slide. When I was a kid, when I was 11, this local school had this sidewalk chalk festival. You know, they kicked all the cars out of the parking lot and brought a bunch of chalk out and said, if all the kids keep going, you're off. And this is what I drew. There's that damn writing shit. All right, thank you very much for coming.
Thank you. It was a great fun.